Hello, I am Pedro Cana. I'm very pleased to be here to deliver this talk. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to address the issue, breach or barrier for achieving the 90-90-90 goals. I want to acknowledge people that helped me to prepare this presentation with their ideas and some slides. So the first question is, why could IRT be a barrier for achieving the 390s? Is there an issue regarding competition for or inefficient use of funds? Has antiretroviral rollout hindered testing and retention in care? Did we take resources and emphasis away from testing and engaging people in HIV care by focusing care so much around antiretrovirals? Are prevention programs harmed by antiretroviral rollout? Could insufficient lab monitoring facilitate emergence of resistance and unchecked toxicities? Does PrEP mean medicalization of the response? And last but not least, being on IRT increases the risk of stigma or discrimination. We know that antiretrovirals save lives. And as you can see here in this UNH figure, the more patients you have on treatment, the lower the figure of the number of people that are dying because of AIDS. So antiretrovirals save lives. Having said that, we are far behind of schedule. As you can see here in the red dot in the bottom of the slide, this is what the point that we should have been by the end of 2020, and this is the point in which we really have been. So really we are missing the target and we are far behind schedule. We need to speed up. Following the current figures, as you can see, the 90-90-90 by the end of 2020 was 84, 73, and 66. That means that 34% of our people living with HIV are still viremic. And this is really an issue to be solved as quick as possible. I do think that it's not a barrier but a bridge for achieving the 390s, because treatment as prevention is really to be understood that treatment is prevention. Treatment is part of the prevention package. We need to test, treat, and retain in care our patients. And antiretrovirals have shown benefits for the individual and for the community. And before we were in the treat all era, testing did not provide any individual benefit compared to the risk of stigma and discrimination. And retention in care was poorly attractive if our patient didn't get a reward for it. So testing and retention in care are absolutely linked to antiretroviral access. Pre-exposure prophylaxis is contributing to reduce incidence rates and among key populations. Treatment as prevention reduces incidence and saves lives. This is very important to be highlighted. And last but not least, again, U equal U is a barrier against stigma and discrimination. And we know that treatment saved lives from long time ago. Look at this paper on November 3rd, 1994, the ACTC 076 regarding reduction of mother-to-child transmission in people with only ACT treatment. And the numbers went down from almost 30% to less than 8%. So a lot of newborn lives were saved by this intervention. And in the year 2000, Tom Quinn studied in Rakai in Uganda, the relationship between viral load level and transmission. And as you can see, with less than 400 copies per ml, there was no transmission. And afterwards, there was a nice dose response relationship between the higher the viral load, higher the chances of transmission. And this is back to year 2000, 21 years ago. In 2006, Julio Montaran and his group made the case for expanding access to heart to curb the growth of the HIV epidemic. This was an ecological study, cohort studies, and then they were confirmed by several studies by Mike Cohen in the study published in the New England Journal of Medicine and many other studies that you can see here that showed that both in gay couples and also in heterosexual couples, transmission is close to zero if you are able to provide antiretroviral therapy and viral load is undetectable in the HIV positive patient. And maybe you can remember this paper by Rochelle Walensky and co-workers stating back in 2006 that the survival benefits of the AIDS treatment in the US have saved more than 3 million years of life in that country. We know that antiretroviral therapy is part of a prevention package, and this is nicely shown here in this figure. But this figure shows a nice symmetry between biomedical, structural, and behavioral issues, but effectively it does not show the relative weight of each intervention. because all are relevant, but putting people on hard avoids unnecessary death, and this needs to be kept in the back of our minds. When we look at the HIV prevention toolkit for avoiding sexual transmission, we know that there are several effective interventions. All that are highlighted by the red circles contain antiretrovirals, microbicide for women, treatment as prevention, oral pre-exposure prophylaxis, and post-exposure prophylaxis. And we know since 2008, since the Swiss statement that was a seminal paper that stated that individuals with undetectable viral load and no STIs cannot admit HIV during sex, giving birth to the undetectable equal transmittable concept, which now has been of a major benefit for our community of people living with HIV, because it's really beginning to change the public perception of HIV transmissibility and reduces highly the chances of stigma and discrimination for people living with the virus. Regarding when to start treatment as to have the maximum benefit of this intervention, we can go back to the San Francisco experience in which they showed that starting antiretroviral therapy on the same day effectively compares to universal ART in the classic way and to CD4 guided ART that we used to use back a couple of years ago. So in the same day treatment, the time to achieve less than 200 copies per ml was less than 2 months. Using the classical universal ART approach, delaying the initiation of treatment took more than 4 months, and using the old CD4 guided ART approach took more than 7 months. So there's no doubt that there is a benefit shown in this study. Also, there is a separate experience by the Thai Red Cross AIDS Research Center in Bangkok, in which they try to start treatment as early as possible to their patients. And as you can see here, the results, effectively, more than 79% started the same day, and 97% started within a week, with very good results at the end of week 24 or month 6, 94% of the patients had less than 50 copies per ml, with a high level of retention, as you can see in the bottom of the slide. And the experience in my region in Haiti, with another very interesting paper by Serena Koenig, you can see here that when you compare in blue standard IRT versus same day initiation, you have more patients that initiate hard, 99% versus 92. You have more patients alive and in care, and you have also more patients in care with less than 50 copies, 53% against 44%. And most importantly, twice as much patients died with a standard IRT group when you compare it to the same day IRT. So starting the same day is a very good idea, and we need to encourage that more countries adopt this strategy. And this evidence drove to the WHO to recommend rapid ART initiation to be offered to all people living with HIV following a confirmed HIV diagnosis and clinical assessment. And eventually initiation should be offered on the same day for those people that are already ready to start. But the unfortunate situation, and I'm giving you an example from my region in Latin America here, is that people show up very late. So now, even in 2019, about 30% of our patients show up with less than 200 CD4s, or eventually with an active opportunistic infection. So we need to expand our testing capacity. We need to reach out people without waiting that they come to the hospital in a passive manner. We need to promote rapid testing and different ways to make it easier for our communities to get access to treatment and to obviously to test before that. There are different strategies to simplify treatment. As you can see here in the list, we can reduce the number of doses a day, reduce the number of pills, reduce the drug dosages, reduce the number of drugs, the number of days on ART, expanding the dose interval using new ways of delivery. And these are all strategies in progress. Some of them have already been approved at least in Western countries. We have several oral fixed dose combination STR regimes. I have highlighted with the red box the dolutegravir/FTC tenofovir, which is the one recommended by the WHO. But in high-income countries and middle-income countries, you have several options of triple and dual therapy strategies that can be considered. Nevertheless, when we look what is the time that the time span between the first approval in a Western country until WHO recommends dolutegravir for all adults, you can see there is a time span of three years to put dolutegravir as part of an alternate first-line regimen, and 6 years until the recommendation was done for all adults. This is a cumbersome process that requires many people, many stakeholders to give their opinion, to discuss, and finally WHO is able to recommend what is needed now, which is an INSTI-based regimen for all adults. When you look at the in this map, what happens in real life, at least at the end of 2020, you can see in dark green, where dolutegravir has been introduced in the national guidelines and procurement has initiated or has already started to be put in practice. When you see the light green is for those countries that have already said, okay, we will introduce it in our guidelines, but procurement has not yet been initiated. And what you see in orange is countries that are still using efavirenz as first line. So we have a long way to go in regards to dolutegravir universal application. And when we look what happens in Africa, for instance, taking in account 20 countries that account for 94% of the regional burden of HIV, only 8 countries, meaning 55% of the regional burden, have adopted dolutegravir for all adults, while dolutegravir for adults, except pregnant women, was adopted by 5 countries, and the other 7 countries either has it as part of the alternate first line or absolutely not recommend dolutegravir in their guidelines. So again, we have here some gaps that we need to close. And we have enough evidence regarding the efficacy of dolutegravir at first line. This important paper published by our Brazilian colleagues with more than 100,000 patients treated, you can see that viral suppression by 1 year was 84% for TLE, that means tenofovir, lamivudine, efavirenz, and it was more than 90% for TLD, tenofovir, lamivudine, dolutegravir, and below 80% for protease inhibitor-based regimen. So this is not about efficacy, this is about effectiveness in real life, and we need to take this in account in order to push more all the countries to adopt the INSTI-based strategy, the TLD strategy as promoted by WHO. So what is needed to achieve our goals? We need to test, treat, and retain. We need to lift testing barriers. We need to promote same-day treatment whenever possible. We need to promote also task shifting within differentiated care. We don't need physicians to be prescribing antiretroviral therapies in all settings. We need to deliver services that are integrated and centered on people's needs. We need to provide multi-month antiretroviral provision, generalized dolutegravir-based single-target regimens, obviously combat criminalization and stigma, and promote social enablers that facilitate people to access the healthcare services. And we need more funding, that is true, but we also need to spend this funding in a more efficient way. Not always we see that there's an absolutely 100% correlationship between funding and the right expenditure of the money. So we need all the things that are listed here. So coming close to the end, I can tell you that the cost of our failure, as UNAIDS has shown in the last report, that we got 3.2 million more infections and 1 million more deaths in the time span between 2015 and 2020. The 1.5 million people who acquired HIV in 2020 were triple the 2020 target of fewer than 500,000 new infections. And if we are able to achieve the 2025 targets, we will reduce the annual HIV infection to fewer than 370,000 and the AIDS-related deaths from 690,000 to fewer than 250,000. So really, this is a struggle that we need to take very seriously and move forward as quick as possible. So we have no more time to waste. HIV/AIDS is a preventable and treatable disease, but so far, 38 million people died because of AIDS. Today and every day, 4,100 new infections are added and counting. Today and every day, 1,900 new fatalities are added and counting. And the question is how many new infections and deaths are we ready to tolerate? Even reaching the triple 90 goals, 27% of people living with HIV will remain viremic and will remain at risk of dying and transmitting the virus. Antiretroviral rollout in the context of facilitated HIV testing, same-day treatment, task shifting, proactive retention in care policies, conflicting stigma and discrimination is the main bridge to ending AIDS. Definitely, ART is the bridge to achieve the 1990 goals. Back to in the year 2000, we wrote with other colleagues an editorial in The Lancet, which is still true. Time to act, global apathy towards HIV/AIDS is a crime against humanity. So the future is life-saving arts should be accessible to everyone and everywhere. I thank you for your attention.